republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have some meeting minutes to approve. First one is on February 13th, 2011. Meeting minutes in regards to our comprehensive plan. Give a motion to have that.
Yep.
We'll make that motion. Motion on the floor by Mike. Can you get a second? Second by Stephanie. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, unanimously. Next one is our February 13th, 2007, and that will be our scheduled council meeting minutes. If there are any additions or corrections, I will need to have a motion to have that. Motion on the floor by Stephanie. Can you get a second? Second by Kyle. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, unanimously. Agenda this evening?
So we are going to remove the Harding Sportsman's Club, add planning and zoning, and also add an exempt permit application for Piers Youth Baseball Club.
So we're, planning and zoning's already on this one?
Yep, I gave you guys updated ones.
Okay, we got the updated ones?
Yep.
Okay, awesome.
I make a motion to accept the agenda with the revisions.
There's a motion on the floor by Steph to accept the agenda for this evening. Second by Mike. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, here's unanimously. Did we have anybody? Hey, guys. I was just going to say, do we have anybody from planning and zoning here?
There's a whole board.
No, we're missing two.
Well, planning and zoning, please, come on up.
We have two building permits. One by Sean Jensen on 509 Park Avenue for replacing the deck. And we approve that. And then a new house with Keith Thielen in Cody Court. I think most of you know where his lot is. It looks fine to us.
I think it's.
The recommendation of planning and zoning, we will need a motion to have these two permits approved.
Who's Cody Court?
Make a motion that we approve the replacing of the deck for Sean Jansen. Those individual work together. And then I guess the motion that we approve the building permit for Keith.
Kelly's on Cody Court, the first one.
Motion on the floor by Steph to approve.
They did originally.
Get a second. Second by Kyle. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, carried unanimously.
Two streets in a parallel.
This is an arrow people. We will take and skip over George Weber's presentation.
It is, I guess.
Go to School District 484, the Community Ed Program donation. The city sponsors that program every year for summer activities for the kids. Cody said we made a donation last year, $2,000 to that.
Yep, it's been $2,000 since 2011.
Okay. Your thoughts?
They do a good job. They have a lot of good programs for the kids throughout the summer and throughout the year.
Yeah, city doesn't specifically have programs for the kids in the summer. I think it's a really neat deal at the school.
I would make a motion that we donate $2,000 to Community Ed Program for the summer program.
Motion on the floor by Mike for a $2,000 donation. Can you get a second? Second by Kyle. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
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 Aye, opposed, unanimously. Freedom Fest, Mr. Lloyd Bader. Good evening.
Good evening. As you know, I'm here for Piers Freedom Fest. This will be our fifth year. And we've come to the city for sponsorship and asking for a donation of $500 each year. And I'm requesting the same for this year. It'll be in July 15th. And
Boy, this is a chance to give the, you know, plug, who do you have for entertainment?
Actually, we probably have the best, one of the best lineups. Well, it is the best lineup we've ever had, and I don't know if we'll ever match it again. We got Trevor Jensen and the Brothers Stone. They're gonna, the gates open at 2, so when the gates open, she'll be already playing. And she's gonna play in between each band that's on. And we got Carla playing at 2, and then at 3 o'clock, we got the Fabulous Armadillos playing. And they'll play from 3 to probably 4:30. And then Carla will come back on. And then at 6 o'clock, we've got, we got Chris Hockey playing. He's on KFAN Radio out of the cities. He's got his own band. And also works with the Vikings doing their setups there for the games. And then at 8 o'clock, we've got Blackhawk. And then at 10 o'clock, we got Neil McCoy. And Neil McCoy, he's talked to every people that have been here. He's actually bringing his whole family out for this to come for the weekend, to come here. So it speaks good for the city, it speaks good for the area, and it speaks good for what we're doing down there, because we've got no, you don't see us in the front page of the Shopper.
You mean the record?
It's still the Shopper to me. Always go to me. Show that to me.
That's the Shopper offer for you.
So that's why I'm here. We expect a good turnout. We get good representation from the organizations in town, the fire department doing the parking. We've got the dance team that's involved. We've got FFA involved. And a lot of other groups that come and help us. So that's
great.
About it.
That's good.
Anybody has any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
To change the date when Lisa's getting married back to
Vegas. You know, it's always
right.
Somebody's day.
I'm making the dance down there, Mary.
Yeah. Tell your niece to move the wedding there. I make a motion that we make our contribution, our $500 sponsorship to the Peers Freedom Fest.
Motion on the floor by Stephanie. Can we get a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Kyle. All those in favor, please signify by
Well, thank you very much. We appreciate it. We'll keep you posted as things go along.
Thanks a lot, Lloyd.
Thanks,
Lloyd. I'm sure the residents of Pierce can all expect a free ticket in their mail.
Almost. We don't have space then. Thank you.
We'll give George a minute to calculate. Application to conduct off-sale gambling, and that is by the Lions, and I believe that is for Oktoberfest. We will need a motion to have that approved, unless somebody has an issue with it.
I'll make the motion to conduct off-sale
gambling. Motion on the floor by Kyle. Can we get a second?
I'll second that.
Second by Mike. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously. Next, we have an exempt permit application, and that is a raffle at Patrick's Bar and Grill Inn.
That is, it's not in there, but it's for the gun calendars that they do each year.
Who sponsors that?
That was the Pierce Youth Baseball Club.
Okay. I do believe they are 501c3.
I make a motion that we approve the gun raffle calendars for Patrick's Bar and Grill.
Motion on the floor by Mike. Can you get a second?
I'll second.
Second by Stephanie. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
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 Aye. Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously.
You're just talking to yourself.
Give me a ballot every once in a while. Hi, George.
Hi, everybody else.
How are we doing tonight?
Good.
Good. George, if you want the floor, you can certainly have it. If you'd like to wait until the end, however you would like to do it.
I'll do whatever. I just wasn't sure where I was relative to the meeting, and you should, if you want to have your meeting and
sure.
Have me kind of that. So
well,
whatever works.
We have only a couple things to go through here, if you want to wait, we could probably give you more time at the end that way.
Yeah, I'd rather have you have your meeting instead of me disrupting it.
Oh, you're not, certainly not disrupting it, so. We can certainly do that, George.
Thanks.
Horizon Health donation. If you guys seen that in here, that's Faith in Action, actually. This is actually to help with transportation. Some of this funding, the way I understand it.
Did you ask for that before?
No.
No, this is the first time. And I couldn't find anything that previously that we've ever donated to them.
No, we haven't. Oh, we sitting with our donation line, pull up to the last couple of days.
No, that, I'm not sure, I have to definitely check after the 2000.
Right. Why don't we do that, let's just double check. Well, we need to know, can we leave?
That was my question, how we talked about it 2 weeks ago.
And I think I'm almost sure Horizon Health is a nonprofit, but yeah, we can certainly check on that.
It doesn't matter if it's nonprofit, we have to watch where we do. It has to benefit the whole community, what we donate to.
So that's why, that was my question last time, and I thought we were gonna check into that. And that's why we tabled it till this time.
Why, we will need a motion then to have that table.
I make a motion to table the Horizon Health donation.
Motion on the floor by Mike.
Second.
Second by Kyle, all those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, carried unanimously. Just kind of as FYI, Nicole's got something on the Bethler Land Survey. Nicole?
I just kind of wanted to let everybody know that they did finish it, and they invoiced us, and I paid them for the full invoice, and then I also invoiced the humans, so.
Okay.
It's just kind of an FYI that.
Sure.
We're moving in the right direction.
For the closing of the human property, what that's all about.
No, I think we're waiting, it's, who's the Open Gold Falls? Mark's an abstract, I think it's kind of handling their business dealings, so I think, not the impression that it'll all be kind of taken care of. At one time, us signing over and them deeding over the, or selling over the property, when the property lines were changed and stuff, but.
Yeah, but there had to be a new legal written.
Right, and I don't think all that is finished, and I was under the impression also, and I'm not sure that's correct, that he had questions he had to answer for our lawyer.
So yeah.
Larson would take care of that, so.
The legal was actually written with the survey, it's just a matter of them taking, compiling all that information.
I think so.
That makes sense. Next, we have our city administrator, six-month review. I can tell you guys, it went pretty rough for me.
I was sweating.
She was sobbing every day, and it's like, you should have been.
We had the chains and shackles out and everything, and we put her on the hot seat. I think we came to the conclusion that, you know, she is doing an outstanding job, given also the circumstances that we put her through with switching over our new computer software. She's got a unbelievable work ethic, so yeah, we felt that her six-month review went well. We are going to recommend to the council that she get a 4% increase from her starting wage. Was it 4%, Linda? Is that what it came out to? What did it come out to? Okay, 8%.
And the reason for that will be explained why.
Equity.
Equity law.
Yeah, the pay equity thing. Nicole is, and this is in no way, shape, or form, and just so you guys understand where we're coming from, is that the state makes sure that when we have a female or even minority that work for our city, that there is a pay equity deal that we need to follow. Nicole's job is going to be considered by the state as similar to our police chiefs. So at the end of 3 years, by the time our next report is due, Nicole will be looking at, if she stays with and she continues to do the job that we're expecting her to do, her salary will be probably somewhere in the neighborhood of the police chief. He's gonna have tenure in his position, which is gonna make up a little difference. There's actually a formula that has to be used for that.
We just have to stay within that alignment.
Yes, yes. And so, this is not only because Nicole is a female, I think she is definitely worth every penny of what we paid her, which she's been able to do for us, so.
I would make a motion to accept her six-month review and the pay increase of 8%.
Motion on the floor by Mike. Can we get a second?
I'll second.
Second by Stephanie. All those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
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 Opposed? Carried unanimously.
What's the discussion?
I'm pleased to work with you guys for 6 months.
No, you've met and exceeded my expectations on a lot of things. Like I said, your work ethic is second to nobody that I've worked with here on city level, so.
I can attest too. She also does a very good job. 2 weeks ago, I accompanied her and Bob Otremba up to Region 5's facility, and Nicole gave a presentation.
Yeah, why don't you guys talk about that for a minute here?
Nicole?
It's on our tap funding.
It's our tap funding for the trail planning.
We applied for a grant, and we had to give a presentation for our region, and it was us, Little Falls, and Cass County, and we all gave presentations, and we came in first for our district, and then we have to go into the second, which I think is March 6th, and then the third round would be April 6th. So hopefully we make it that far. If not, we're going to be applying again next year, but we made the first round, so that's good news.
So yeah, to finish there was it puts our city in a good spot to, maybe get some funds for that program. So it's going to be, it was nice. You guys did a good job the way I understand it. So
Cole did a wonderful job.
Good. Thank you guys for all the time. Yeah, Mike and Bob went along and Nicole told.
We just went up there for the question and answer period. She wanted to know, you guys want to come? I said, they'd much rather look at you than Bob and I. She did a great job.
Good.
Actually, beating all Little Falls was rather surprising because they had a little video presentation of somebody getting pedestrian actually getting hit and crosswalked by the school. And thought, boy, how can we beat that? But we did. So anyway, but thanks again, Nicole.
Yep. I'd like to set up a workshop with the city council. Coming up here, we have several things to try and get through, and I'd also like our city engineer here at that time have some questions about some development things, and Nicole and I came up with a whole list of things that we need to sit down and work out. One problem we have is it sounds like Dave is going to be pretty sewed up with the few things that he's got going on. So over the next several weeks. So, but we need to probably get on some of this stuff. So if Dave can make it, great. If he can't, I guess that's fine too. So
you guys got a date in mind?
Well, we had some that Scott could be here.
Yeah, he said March 20th, 22nd, and 23rd would work for him. The week after that, he will be out on vacation.
I cannot do the 22nd. I could do the 28th or the 23rd.
I also, 22nd, I'll be on for sure. Okay. The 20th or 23rd is great.
Okay. You, Kyle.
It's
tax season.
Tax season will still be on.
So I'm just making sure I don't have anything. Is it the
20th or the 23rd?
So Monday or Thursday of that same week.
Mm-hmm. And what time of day are we talking about?
Doesn't matter. Usually evenings. Yeah, usually do them in the evenings, 5:30, 6 o'clock, something like that. And I can envision this for at least a couple hours, so.
I always say that, and then it goes four. Just thought I'd point that out.
6 o'clock.
Yeah, probably.
6 would break up?
Yeah, that would work, and I mean, Monday and Thursday would both probably work for me. Thursday probably would be more preferable.
So is that the point?
Let's go for the 23rd.
6 o'clock?
Yes.
And Nicole, you wanna get ahold of Scott, make sure he can be here to look.
Make a motion that we set a city workshop meeting for Thursday, March 23rd at 6 p.m.
Report by Mike, can we get a second?
Second by Kyle, all those in favor, please signify by stating aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Carried unanimously.
See Bobby Gold's coming up. I don't think we have any, unless Nicole had something.
Nope, I just wanted to let you guys know, we're finishing up the 2016 audit stuff, so just making all the financial transactions. They gave us quite a few pages with the conversions, we're just slowly working through that, making sure we do it right. And we have not received any golf course applications yet.
For the golf course, none?
None for them yet. So what I did is I went and posted on the League of Minnesota Cities website.
Okay.
So you can post them there for free.
Okay.
And I just put some up in the library, and I was gonna maybe see if we can maybe hang some at the school.
Well, we have a man here to ask tonight on that.
Yeah, some people that are 18 and older from high school.
Yeah, that's the thing we have to be careful with the clubhouse, because we're serving alcohol, so they gotta be 18.
Have to ask George about his recruiting skills.
Recruiting skills, maybe George needs a summer job.
Well, I was just saying, maybe George needs a little summer income.
Maybe you do, huh?
Okay, you guys, let's wrap up our portion, and we'll turn the floor over to Superintendent George Weber, the Pierce School District. George is gonna talk a little bit about upcoming plans that the school district has for some construction and a bond referendum that may be coming up, so we'll turn it over to George.
Thank you.
Welcome.
He's a thing, can I borrow this chair?
Sure.
Absolutely.
There is a time pod of sorts. You okay?
Yeah.
Sure. Actually, George, if you want to put it up here so the camera can see it. I've got, actually have it on my
Keeps morphing slightly, so I don't know what version you have.
It's the morphing version.
So I'm just here to let you know that the school board did vote last Wednesday night at a regular school board meeting to proceed with the bond referendum. So it'll be a special election. The date we selected is Monday, May 22nd, and we're kind of they're limited for special election dates. Basically, the last one you can do them at all this whole year is June 12th, unless you go out for the primary or the general. Those are the only options the school board has. So we kind of targeted May. That's pretty common with districts. We didn't want to go into June. Part of it is you kind of lose track of communicating with your parents and stuff, so at least we still see them in the month of May. So then we actually were looking at Tuesdays, because normally that's the day. It can be any day. So we were looking at May 23rd, which would have been that Tuesday, but we saw that section track is that day. I think it's at St. John's. Section varsity, section softball that day in Wade Park. We thought we don't want to mess with that. We didn't have any events scheduled on Monday, so we thought we'll just go with Monday the 22nd and try to keep that day as free as possible, although spring scheduling is a challenge, but certainly we don't want a team on the road that day. I've got some information in here. Let's talk about the election a little bit because we'll be involved. Right now we have 4 designated polling places, and they are the city halls in Harding, Pierce, and Buckland. So it's our job to staff those. We'll have to pay for the election judges. It's on the school district to pay for basically any special election. So we'll have to hire judges and get that all set up. And our polling times are noon to 8. The law requires 5 to 8 is the minimum, but we wanted to have a little more. So, So the challenge would be, I kind of wish they had flexibility on where you vote, but you don't, the designated townships are assigned to, like the Harding townships have to vote in Harding, and the Lastrip townships have to vote in Lastrip. You can't, which is kind of frustrating, because you could be in Piers that day, and you can't really vote if you live in Harding. So we'll have to get that word out. That's kind of out of our control. There's nothing we can do with that. There is a provision for absentee ballots, so that will be available for anybody. So we'll get more information on that.
That out on the, at a county level then, George?
Pardon me?
Do you do that at a county level, or is that a...
Yeah, we have to go through the county.
Okay.
So I'm not sure what qualifies, like I don't know whether or not, let's say if you're in a nursing home, can you fill out absentee? I was just imagining we don't want to have to call people to the polling place, but maybe, I haven't even researched that part of it, we'll find out who can fill out an absentee ballot. Do you actually have to be away from home to fill it out, or can anybody fill it out? I think it's pretty flexible, but we'll see, so...
For the regular election, we go to the nursing home and find out who wants to vote.
Okay.
They're asked, and then if they want to vote, then we pick up their ballots, take them there, and then take them back to the courthouse after they're sealed. So I'd assume it'd be the same for this.
Okay. Well, I hope so. I'm just trying to make it as easy as possible for everybody. So.
Yeah.
And there's quite a bit of work we have to go through to change polling places. So these are the four we had last time. We just said we might as well leave them the same, otherwise it's a lot of, you have to get special permission to adjust those. So that's the plan, and that'll be coming up pretty soon. It's only a few weeks away. So I've done some work at getting the word out. I've been presenting at parent-teacher conferences for Pioneer and Ely. I went to the Lions Club. I mean, I will plan on getting out of the Lions, so I went to the commercial club. But I'll get more data as time goes on. For the most part, this is what I've been handing out, and for the most part, it's accurate. A little bit of change on the cost, exactly. We still stayed with that $18 million figure. The reality is the cost of all these projects is probably going to push over $20 million. But we're able to get about $2 million in what's called LTFM money. It's long-term facilities maintenance. We can use it from the state. It's only to fix existing property, and only if that property is not being repurposed. So I can't change one room into this room and then use it for something different and qualify. But we're doing our work to see how much of it we could get out of that funding, and we found out that we can get about $2 million out of it. So that we really tried to push that so we would lower the ask on our local voters. And so the $18 million in construction is what we plan on using, and that's what we're going to ask for in the referendum. The irony is we actually have to ask for $18.45 million because of the cost of the bonds and because of the fact that we have to make the initial interest payment. If you go out in May, you'll have a payment due yet in 17. The taxes won't happen until 18, and we have to make that payment. And again, the law says that payment has to come out of the bond proceeds itself, which is too bad. I would love to make that payment out of our general fund money and keep it at 18, but they won't let us. We have to actually account for that payment in the bond itself. So in order to get $18 million in actual construction, we have to ask for an $18.5 million bond. So that's just
you
kind of out of our hands. But that's
wouldn't
the way
think they care where the interest came from.
that's the rule. So even the cost of the bonds itself, paying the bond agencies, has to come out of the bond proceeds. It can't come out of any other school coffers. So we didn't really have a choice.
George, is this 20 years or 30 years?
25. And we'll evaluate interest rates. We actually, our plan is to, at this point, to go out for two bonds, actually, because there's a law in Minnesota that if you have less than $10 million of bond debt in any given calendar year, you're automatically bank qualified. And by being bank qualified, we can lower the interest rate by about 0.5%. So the difference between, you know, 4.3 and 3.8 could turn out to be a lot of money over time. And so rather than go up for one $18 million bond, we're going to plan on going out for two, probably one $10 and one $8 million bond. So we'll just, and we'll just gauge interest rates at the time that the bonds sell to decide what we want to do, and whether it's 8 plus 10, or if the rates are great, 2.5%, we'll do all we can at once and lock in, but we most likely won't do that. Most likely we'll get a better rate if we go up twice.
George, will there have to be two bond questions then on the ballot?
No, because the question, yeah, what the voters would be doing would be giving the school board $18 million of bond authority, and then the board can decide how they want to use that authority. So, and we actually believe we'll get the best tax impact if we go out twice rather than go out once, just because of Minnesota laws. And we've got enough cash flow, we can, you know, survive a year, we're not going to spend 9 of it in 1 year anyway. You know, it'll be a 2-year project by the time we're all done, so. So those are just intricacies of Minnesota laws that you sort of play the game, and hopefully you can try to save some money here and there, and that's what we're trying to do. So. It's a big project. 18 is a big number, and I know that that's kind of scary. But what we're all doing, and I can try to go over it if you can see the picture, the biggest needs are, we're a growing school district, and some of you have heard me say this before, but on the very, very, very first day of the school year this year, I told our staff that you realize that every day we have school now, we're the second largest city in the county. So we've got about 1,400 people in those buildings every day. So it's a good story. And so we're growing, and we've added what, 6 classrooms on in the K-3 wing. The reality is when they turn into be 4th and 5th and 6th graders, there's no room for them. So we've added on to one side, and we have 4 sections now of kindergarten, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd. Next year they're going to be in 4th, the year after they're going to be 5th, yeah, you know, so on and so on. We have to deal with the fact that we have, we were built in 1990 for about 350 children, and now we have about 670 with preschool in that school. So it's a good story, and the numbers are there, and it's exciting, and I think that. We have a lot of good things going on at Pioneer Elementary. I really would encourage people to spend a day there. You'd be kind of amazed at what children are doing, so especially with some of the technology things, it's pretty cool. So we're happy with that, and we think we've been hopefully good for the community, and hopefully the community continues to support it, and we'll go there. So we need classrooms for sure. We need a band room. For those of you who haven't been in a band room or seen it, it was built in 1963. You recall that's the old junior high. And at the time, band and choir were there for junior high, and that's still been the band since. It's about 1,000 square feet below what the state would approve if we were ever to build one new to hold the students that are in it. So, and the reality is we've gone through a few band directors, all of them who wear earplugs every day they teach. So we assume keep a good band director and build them an adequate space. So to me, those are needs, you know, to me. Even if we don't do anything, I still need a band room and I need classrooms. So I consider those as what I call urgent needs. The other things on here, we'd like an auditorium. We feel like the schools our size, most of them do, a lot of smaller schools than us do. Our community doesn't have one. We've got a really strong instrumental music program, choir program, and musical theater program. And we feel like right now, you know, it's amazing, our choir, that more than half of the children in grade 7, 12 are in one of our choirs. You know, think of the old days, back when I went to school, you couldn't prompt your kid to join choir, and now almost everybody is in one of them. So it's a great thing. So we want to keep supporting that. We did community theater last year. And I just think even a space for anybody, if you ever want to have a speaker to come in and seat 100 people, we really don't have that in our community. So I think the auditorium is a good investment. And again, that's not a crisis like the band and classrooms are, but we feel it's a very worthwhile thing to add on to our school and for our community. And the other piece is along with the gym space at Pioneer and all the children's, right now we're walking kids over every day for band and for Fayette because the elementary gym cannot hold all the children that are in that school. If you've seen it, that's a very, very small gym. And so we want to build actually a gymnasium that will connect the two schools. We have a lot of traffic going back and forth every day, staff, students, paras going back and forth. And so it was going to be a change to the campus, but kind of exciting to have the schools connected. And so that's what we're planning on doing. And we plan on putting a 3-station gym. It's one gymnasium. I know I've heard some talk that the school's building 3 gyms. And, you don't call them MAC 3 gyms. It's just got 2 courts in it. Well, this is one gym that's got 3 courts in it. But it hopefully will meet our needs. And actually, our original plans, the teachers saw back in January, and I'm not sure which of the morph diagrams you've seen, that was a 4-station gym. We were trying to figure out how to build the auditorium into the pack. And for the same cost of shrinking that gym, we were able to pay for the auditorium seating and could save the pack. We just really like that model a lot better because it was hard to fit the seating into the pack anyway. And we had a lot of flow issues about how to get kids back and forth. I mean, the girls' locker room, it'd be really hard to move that. And so then there'd be auditorium seating in the way of them and all the other gyms. So it was kind of a hassle to try to pull that off. We were trying. But this, we think, is a lot cleaner. So then what we're doing for classroom space, and this is a change too. For the longest time, we were trying to figure out how to add to the 4-6 wing. and the school's designed for that. It's hard to cut into that roof. If we ever live life over again, we wouldn't build that metal roof that Pioneer has. It's really expensive to add on to that part, just by getting a flat roof's a lot cheaper. But what we found is that we could save $500,000 by converting the existing Pioneer gym into two stories of classrooms. So because we have a gym for them anyway, we're going to take their old gym, and that's where the new classrooms are going to be. So we can fit 8 classrooms plus a large room, probably a science lab, for 5th and 6th graders to use in that gym space. And it's a lot cheaper than building on the outside. Plus, it's space we're already heating now in a roof that we already have. So we just like that model. And even some of the teachers first were kind of wedded to the expansion, and then we kept thinking, even for moving children around and getting too spread out, it's nice to pull back in and convert that gym. So that's what we plan on doing. Their elementary children will have access to the other gym anyway every day because we're not getting rid of the pack. The high school students will still have access to those gyms. So during the school day, we can keep the elementary fi-ed here. And then in the evening, we like the idea that we can still run our events, C-Squad, JV, in the pack and the MAC, and somebody else could be elementary, junior, JV, junior high. Anybody could be practicing in the gym really without us bothering any of the other events going on. So.
George, should the private school have problems or whatever and would have a need to close, is there enough room to accommodate?
That's a good question. And I actually talked about that today. Somebody else asked me the same question. Frankly, my political answer is I feel like if Holy Trinity ever shut down, the community wouldn't understand and we'd figure out what we're going to do. And if I plan for it, then I look pretty bad.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to plan for it. I'll wait for it to happen. But I also think that this would become a solid 4-section school with this addition, with some extras. And I don't know for sure that their shutting down would force us to be a 5-section school. Some grades maybe, but probably not all grades. And so I think we may only be a few rooms short, depending upon where we need targeted space, and we still could add a room on the back side if we wanted to. So I think we wouldn't need, like, 7 new rooms. Mm-hmm. It would time we'd evaluate where the numbers are and go at it that way. You know, preschool and stuff is a challenge.
Another question I hear out in the community is open enrollment. What percentage of ours?
It's good. We're pushing between 23% and 25% in any given year.
And all of that money follows them
right
to our school district?
Right. That's a question on taxes. Right now, if you run the numbers, it's about 90-10. So about all of the money that any district gets down on a child, in the old days, it was way more local taxes. These days, the state picks up a much bigger share. So for every child in Minnesota, it's about 90% state, 10% local. So it's a minimal amount per child that we wouldn't get. But they've also made some adjustments with that, even to local levies, where now they have formulas. It used to be they actually, for a while, they were billing the home district. They would pull some of the levy money and send it if you had a negative or a positive relative to open enrollment.
Okay.
Now they stopped that model, but what they've done is, it used to be, this is a change about 6 years ago, like when we would do an excess levy, like a $200 per student, we would only get it on our resident students. We would never get it on the open enrollment. They've changed that. So now they're equalizing all the open enrollment, and if we have a $200 per child levy, it's on all 1,200, not the 900 that are just here. So that's a benefit that helps us. And
but the building part is paid only by District 44, correct? Or not correct?
We'll get some equalization. It's kind of funny how the state works with that. I don't like their model. Their model, I feel like, doesn't favor smaller districts because you have to construct so much to get state aid. Let's say right now we don't get any state aid because we only have about $4 million in debt. But this would push us over there, like about once you get to past about 15, the state starts paying. And the bigger you get, the more they start paying, which I think is a bad. If I was king for a day, I would go to the state and say, why are you doing that? You're almost giving districts an incentive to overbuild because their state aid kicks in.
Right.
The more they build. But that's life. That's how it works. There's some, so we would generate, this would push our total levy up to about $1.2 million a year. Right now it's about $300,000 just on construction bonds. And once we get past that like that $1 million in the state would start paying. So about, I know it's a complicated question, and I'm trying to answer it, but probably what we'd get, not 50-50 on the whole works, but we'd get about 50% on everything the locals have to pay, that's above $1 million. So like your first $1 million is on you every year, but after that it's 50-50 state aid. And that's just how the formula works. And that would keep going the higher the number went. So,
what is the bond payment on that, George? Did you guys calculate
it? It's about that $1.2 million a year.
$1.2
yeah.
million a year.
Yeah.
One more question.
So like I said, the last $200,000, that would be subsidized.
We were voted to have the greatest gym in the world just a year ago, and now we don't. Now we have to build one that's even larger. And we had three gyms within 100 feet of each other, but we don't have adequate gym space.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Well, if you were a coach, trying to coach one of the 14 different teams that we have at any given time in the winter, they would say, yes, we don't have adequate gym space. Now, this gym probably wouldn't be our competition gym. We would still play our games in the one that people voted for as the best one. So I'm not sure, maybe this would have a wood floor, but it's more of a practice space than it is a game space.
Well, you know, lease, you always also lease over at Holy Trinity, or don't you,
right.
or whatever.
Yep.
So we'd have four gyms within 1,000 feet, but we don't have enough. So we have to build a new one that has three more floors. Correct? Where am I wrong?
Right now we have four courts. PAC has one, the MAC has two, and Pioneer has one. So that's four places for teams to practice. And we have a C-Squad JV varsity girls team, a C-Squad JV varsity boys team, a junior 8th, 7th, and 8th grade girls team, a 7th and 8th grade boys team, every winter for sure, and that doesn't include any elementary teams. So, yeah. I don't know, to answer your question, is it enough? I mean, we schedule them, we make it work.
Aren't you replacing the Pioneer Elementary gym with classrooms, though?
Yeah. So we'll lose that.
Is it going to be an elevator then?
Yes, we'll need an elevator. We can't go two stories without an elevator. And that's a little bit pricey, but not bad. We put one in the fitness center. It was about $65,000. So, I mean, that's a lot of money, but when you're talking a whole other floor, that's not bad, because the cost of a whole other space is, you know, compare that, or even plan up parking spaces. I told the school board when we looked at that, I said, say $65,000 over 10 years is $6,000 a year, you'd love to have that parking lot back if you made it flat and didn't, you know, go up and down with it. So it's...
George, I got a question that I think maybe affects us all, and I've heard some comment, and I want to get it straight from you. We have 2 years, was it 2 years ago, or are we in third year now? We kind of switched that bond, that $10 million bond. What do we have left to pay on that? It's only been a couple of years, so I can assume that. Didn't we roll one over a couple of years ago?
Paid one off.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we added the elementary.
Added the
math.
Yeah, one bond is paid off. So
what was the last bond referendum we had?
It was to, when Pioneer got paid off, we built the choir room and the tennis courts and the five elementary classrooms just by saying we're going to keep taxes the same as they were before. And so that was about $4 million.
That was about $4
million. What we did is looked at the $300,000 that we used to pay and said we were going to continue paying that much, what kind of money could we generate? And that's how we got to the $4.5 million. The project cost $5.4 million, but we didn't want to raise taxes,
okay.
So we
that's
kept
what it was.
At that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so, and we're talking another 18,
yep.
part of 20
yep.
million.
So the total bond debt would be about 22.
Yeah.
And that's where that $1.2 million per year would come in. That would be our core payments for both of them.
Is that a safe amount, do you believe, for a community and district the size of ours? It seems like a lot of money when you compare to bigger districts. We're getting in the same kind of gap mode. I see some of the bigger districts.
Well, if you want to look on the back page here, I actually have tax comparisons to every district that borders us. And the Pierce column would be if it passed. So even if it passed, compared to everybody else around us, we're in the middle or certainly not at the top. Right now, we're by far the lowest. Right now, our taxes, this is on a $100,000 house, are $411. So we're well under everybody around us. And this is comparing our data, if it passed, to their 2016 data, because that's the only data I could get. The two that I did try to change on here were Little Falls and Sartell, because they both passed bonds in 16. So there's taxes, they're being taxed on that now in 17. So I tried to find that and add that to their numbers. But all the other ones, Brainerd, Sauk Rapids, Holy Up, Silverwealth, and Malacca, are the taxes that their voters paid in 2016 on a $150,000 house just for bond debt. So, are we, yeah, that'll make us average. We're well below average now.
When you talked about, I think, another meeting I was at, when you're talking about that multi-gym space, you talked about it being more than one level and there being like a track for people, for the community to go and walk like they do the halls right now, so there'd be that type of availability for the community to use that. Does that
yeah,
still
there'll be a
plan?
Walking path around the
around
gym.
The top of it.
Yep.
And then also they can use the inside, I think you talked about, for tennis if they can't be outside.
Right.
And was it baseball, something else,
right.
Maybe some of the outdoor sports, this would have some availability to use that
yeah,
for indoor practice.
I mean, we have basketball needs, but certainly baseball, softball has nowhere to go when they have bad springs.
Okay.
Our football team goes to Foley every fall. When we end up going into November with practices, we just drive them to Foley to practice. So.
George, how do you see this affecting, and I know this is hard for you to say, and I'm just asking you for not specifics, but how do you see this affecting our school district's annual levy amount?
Well, this is what it would be. So, as far as any other costs,
every year we need more money to operate this every year. I mean, we're looking at, let's just say, a 5% usual increase. Is this going to take an extra 2% to try and run this, or 1% or 5%? I guess I don't know.
That's a good question, but that's where the money we use to pay custodians and pay the heat doesn't come from any local levy. That's where the state aid comes in. So whatever I got to do to pay those costs wouldn't be taxed here. It would be the open enrollment money. It would be the other money that we bring in pays for those annual costs. So this would just be on the construction itself.
If we had no outside students, would we have to build in the foreseeable future? If we had none, just our own?
I don't know.
So that's 25% of our people.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't adding 25% to the facility. So it seemed like we'd be actually overbuilt right now. Where am I wrong?
Well, if we didn't allow any open enrollment in, I'd have to fire 1 in 5 people that work there to start with. Right? If I lose 1 in 4 children, I'm losing at least 1 in 5 staff.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm questioning the building. You said we're talking about $18 million over 30 years or whatever.
But it's hard to answer your question because those children have been there a long time. You know, we've got people that came for 10 years already that are coming from Hillman or Freedom or Morrill or wherever. So I'm not sure how we would decide who to boot out or how we would do that.
Or either you accept all of them or none of them. Is that not correct?
Right. Well, you can close certain grades if you want to. That's a challenge, but there's some districts that do that. You could say a third grader is too full, we can't take them, or third graders. The problem is a family comes in with a third grader and a sixth grader and an eighth grader, and you're going to lose all three of them. But that's some districts have done that.
I'm sorry, I have a question. So if we were to close the open enrollment, where would the students go that are from Morrill and
But I don't know what our resident numbers are for like 5-year-olds and 6-year-olds and 7-year-olds. Would we still need 4 sections in first grade or second grade? Maybe. I'd have to look at that.
George, if you guys
25% is spread over 13 grades.
So it doesn't necessarily mean one grade suddenly can cut a teacher. You know what I mean? It's all over the place. I'm sorry, totally.
No, it's going to something that would take more time, but just, have you heard anything from the federal government with the new commissioner of education and the credit they want school districts to give back to the kids to go to other schools, private schools, that sort of thing? Don't you think that's really going to probably be a non-factor with somebody like, we have a bunch of schools to compete with in the area?
Well, for the most part, and luckily, the federal government doesn't impact me too much. I mean, it's really sped and title that they run. So, frankly, I wish they'd fully fund sped. If they did nothing else with that, I'd be happy. So I don't know, I mean, to get political, but I said that to one of my brothers, that it's kind of how meaningless the federal education person is when it kind of doesn't matter. You know, Arnie Duncan was there too, and he cheated on test scores in Houston, and the world didn't change. Our school is still our school. Children still come, you know.
The Secretary of Education is anti-public school.
Right, right.
Has never attended a public school, taught in one, or sent her kids to one, and she favors charter schools.
Right.
And this will have no effect on our district.
Well, I just don't feel like that position wields enough power to pull off those things.
That's her position right now. It always has been. What do you mean, pull off those things? It is what it is.
Right.
But I don't know what charter schools we have.
Yeah, I don't know who we have to compete with.
That would draw people.
Any
type of private school is
important. The federal government doesn't run charters. The state runs charters. So I just don't know how that position can make those changes. They don't have the authority to make the changes that you're implying or she would like to make.
Then how did Colorado do it, where they got 50% of their kids in charters?
Well, that would be
because she's from there. I favor public schools.
Oh, me too.
I mean, duh.
Obviously.
But
I just,
Tony, the same way they got the marijuana law passed over there.
I don't like the selection, but I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. Because I got bigger things to sleep over than her. So that's how I see it.
That is a big chunk of money.
Yes.
What happens if it doesn't pass? How do you accommodate the kids that are coming up through the grade school?
Well, I don't know. I guess the one thing I didn't mention, you can see that the parking lot's being rebuilt too, so there's another big chunk of the money's going that way. I've asked that, what's your plan if it doesn't pass? And I feel like, I could have one, but I think it would depend upon why it didn't pass. You know what I mean? To have a plan in place, I almost feel like I'd learn a lot more from looking at what happened and then decide what we're going to do about it. I would need to add on classrooms, for sure. And so whether we do that two at a time for 5 years in a row, we could. That's an expensive way to do it, because you're building two rooms, shutting down the wall, tearing down that wall next year, breaking into it again. I mean, but I really don't have a choice. It's in our best interest to keep them. It's in our best interest to accommodate them. I would certainly recommend that over closing open enrollment, because this has been an economic benefit. It's not only an educational benefit, but it is an economic benefit.
Have you been having to rent, or do you foresee having to rent those modular?
We're using four right now.
Yeah, that's how
we have four modulars right now being used at Pioneer. We're looking at that. We'll see. So
that would be one of your alternatives if this doesn't be using more modulars while you build two rooms at a time.
Actually, we're on the horn to mod space already, just because, let's cross our fingers and the voters do vote yes, we have to move the modulars to even start the gym. So I've already got a challenge this summer with where our preschool is going to be, even if it passes. And so we're looking at those options, and sometimes we'll see, but it might be cheaper for us to rent from them than for us to physically move and reset up, though sometimes that's the case, because they'll do the installation and the setup if you pay the rent for a year. So those are all things we're looking at, but something has to happen.
Would any of the modulars be eliminated if this passed?
Well, we're renting the ones in the back, for sure.
But would they be limited?
Well, since you named two parts of this project as urgent, and then you added a few more, did you do that because there's a financial benefit to doing it all at once, as opposed to doing it piecemeal? I mean, you talked about adding two classrooms, it's an expensive way to do it, but is there a financial benefit, or is it just less disruptive to the district to get these things done in 2 years than have it drag over 10?
Both are true. It's less disruptive, and certainly when you bid a big project, you get better numbers. We actually, we're going to add on to the Head Start, and we're decided not to. We went to open our bids last Friday, or Friday the 17th, and the bids were too high. We just said it would have been $700,000 for a classroom and some offices, and that's because of the cost of adding a TV thing. You know, structural steel companies say it doesn't matter whether you're doing five or one, we're not going to fire up the factory because they build them, you know, cost $50,000 for your steel trusses, whether it's one classroom or five. So that's the nature of that. Precast concrete, you know, they're not going to, you got to give them a 4 month lead time, you know, otherwise they won't send it to you.
Right now.
Yeah, so for sure. So we're actually not even going to do that project. We were going to pay that all out of fund balance. We just said, no, that's too much money for one classroom. So we're going to hold off, figure out what we're going to do to make it through the year next year. Remodel one of the rooms, so Head Start will still be there. We're going to have to find a different place for ECSE. I broke the news of those teachers last Friday, so I used the deal. I actually showed them the bid numbers so they could see why. And once it, you know, they realized that we'd save $200,000 by packaging it with this, then why wouldn't we? You know, right? Otherwise, I'm kind of wasting taxpayers' money too. You know, it would be nice, but it just doesn't make sense. So.
You do save some mobilization fees too, and it doesn't sound like much, but it's considerably expensive to have that kind of equipment and things that are around too.
So that's, yeah, but we feel like those are needs. I mean, do we need an auditorium? Maybe not, but jeepers, we're packing chairs in the gym all the time. We've been to a Christmas concert. It's getting to be torture, frankly, because it's crowded and it takes forever, you know. So we just think it's a good asset for our community. So I don't know, I'd go piece by piece if it doesn't pass and just see what we have to do. And as far as the gym space goes, I would probably need to add on to Pioneer's gym then, somehow, even if we didn't put the one between. That gym still isn't adequate. We still have 600 children every day that need play ed, and that gym can't house them. So I'd have to do something there too. So those are all piece by piece, we'd figure out how to solve our problems, basically, is what I would do. So.
Well, George, thank you very much for coming and making that presentation to the City Council and the residents here. And everybody at home who has cable, be able to listen to this too. If you would like to sit down with me and maybe a couple members of the community or whoever you'd like, another school board member or something, and do a kind of a round table discussion, more in detail about your project, we'll give you that invitation. You're welcome to come back and do that. We'll get it on the access channel so people will be able to do it.
And I think the board would like to host a public meeting anyway, so we'll see. We may plan on that at some point, so we'll see how that goes. There's a couple pieces of legislation. There's one called Ag to School Credit I reference in here. That's going to help districts. I'm 90% sure it's going to pass. The only reason it didn't pass last session was because there was no tax bill. It was in the bill, signed by everybody, but there was no tax bill last year. So there'll be about a 40% credit back to ag land. That's specific to school bond construction. That's why it's called Ag to School. It's only for that purpose. And so that will help when that passes in May, and I can't. You know. And the other piece, there's some legislation going on that has to do with that equalization that I talked about, that debt service equalization that will sort of move that target down, so they'll start to give the aid a little sooner instead of waiting until you have at least $1 million in payment. Maybe it'd be $900,000 or something. That'll be spread across the state, but talking to Creech and Gazelka about those bills too to see if we can get them passed. And that would help all sectors. That would be, the equalization one would be on businesses, homestead, everything. The Ag to School one would be just on ag land, not homestead, on the ag land itself. And I'm quite confident that's going to, that has a ton of support, especially from southwestern Minnesota, where you have small districts in Egglands, $8,000 an acre, you know, down there. They're really footing the bill for their school projects, they're just claiming they can't anymore. So
yeah,
I'm quite certain that's
somebody's gotta foot the bill though.
Yeah, but that's gonna pass. I'm just confident it will. Everybody has it in their bill, Senate does, House does, Governor does, so that'll help. At least for that portion. Once I get that data, we'll get a brochure that has specific tax impact on all sectors, probably within a month for sure.
Very good.
Yeah, thanks again, George. Appreciate you coming.
It's exciting. I guess to me it is a lot, but I also feel like we're asking for what we think is approval. We've driven the dollars down. This project was bigger than that. We've told the people that 18 is our number. We're not going to go more than that. So.
And it is a fact that our area is growing, not in the school district. I mean, when people come here to City Hall looking at moving in or whatever, I mean, one of the big draws of this area is definitely our school district. And that's a commend.
I hope so. We're always vigilant.
Would there be added staff over the next few years with this project? After
well, expanded? We added this year in both sections of K-3. So, I mean, we added 15 new teachers this year. It wasn't all added, some were retirements, but sure. I mean, never. 15 is a ton to a staff of about 80. I mean, that's a big turnover. So, it's pretty exciting, frankly. So.
Well, thanks again, George.
Thank you.
Like I said, you're welcome to come back if you'd like to.
If you have a question, they can call me or whatever.
Thanks, George.
Thank you.
If anybody doesn't have anything else, we want to get a motion to adjourn.
Sometimes the rules here is on the state and rest.
Anybody else have anything?
I'll say this is the night of
Jensen retired.
No. Now we got a new one coming up.
You?
I said new. College wrestler.
This is a special wrestler. College wrestler that's done in college now. That's our.
Clint learned a lot. Well, throughout the world with them.
Clint's a wonderful wrestler. Is he a wrestling coach?
I know he's a wrestler. He's helping a lot.
I know he's a